Let us see some more deductions in respect of Section 36, Subsection 1. Now, there could be a case where a company can incur expenditure in respect of family planning amongst its employees, right? This expenditure can either be of a revenue nature or it can be of a capital nature. The revenue expenses which are incurred by a company to promote family planning amongst employees is allowed as a deduction to the extent of 100%, right? But if it is a capital expenses, right, then you ascertain what is the total amount of expenses. Let's say it is 500, right? 1/5 for each year from the year when incurred. So 1/5 of this amount, let's say this is 100, okay, this is going to be allowed as a deduction in 5 years starting from the year when it was first incurred. So if you incurred it in financial year, let's say 2010 2011, then 10, 11, 11, 12, 12, 13 and all like this, for 5 years you will get a deduction of rupees 100 each. If for some reason you are not able to claim the entire expenditure because the income is less, then the carry forward is allowed in a manner similar to unabsorbed depreciation, right? Non-corporate employees can claim a deduction under Section 37(1). Or Section 32. Now this is a case what we were discussing for a company. If you are not a company, if you are, let's say for example, a partnership firm, right, then the deduction is available to you under Section 37(1) if it is a revenue expenditure, or under Section 32 if it is a capital expenditure. Section 32 governs depreciation, right? So if you incur a capital expenditure, you get depreciation under 32. If it's a revenue expenditure, you can claim deduction under the general section. Now, insofar as the carry forward is concerned, again, the carry forward is allowed in a manner similar to unabsorbed depreciation, which means that you need to just go back to the previous slide to check what are the rules relating to carry forward of unabsorbed depreciation. Securities transaction tax, just in case you are not aware, this is a tax which is levied on purchase and sale of securities on the stock exchange, right? So securities transaction tax paid by a business is allowed as a deduction provided it is in respect of taxable securities transactions entered into in the course of business. So if I am not incurring this expense in the course of my business, this is a personal expense which I am incurring, right, then it is not allowed as a deduction. Provision for bad and doubtful debts. Now normally a provision for bad and doubtful debt is not allowed as a deduction for companies. What this provision wants to cover here is that for rural branches of bank and cooperative banks, this is allowed as a deduction. So if let's say for example you are a rural branch of a bank. Rural branch, again, you have to see what qualifies as a rural branch, right? But if let's say for example you qualify as a rural branch of a bank, then if you make a provision for bad and doubtful debts, that is allowable as a deduction. And similarly for the cooperative banks also, this is allowed as a deduction. Some of the other ones are special reserve created by financial corporations. We will see it in detail. Employer contribution to a pension scheme, that is also allowed as a deduction. Pension is basically if an employee retires from a company. So let's say you are an employee, you worked for a company. After you retire, you don't have any source of income, right? So normally what used to happen mainly in the government sector is the government used to give you a pension, which is a smaller amount as compared to your regular salary, but it is given in order to ensure that you are able to meet up your regular expenses. Now many companies have now floated these pension schemes where, you know, even if you're not a government employee, you can make a contribution during your employment, and once you retire, then you get a pension from this. Okay, so the employer contribution to this pension scheme is also allowed as a deduction. The last one which we have in this slide is discount on zero coupon bonds, right? Issued by an infrastructure capital company or an infrastructure capital fund or a public sector company. Now, zero coupon bonds, what happens in these cases is that, you know, there are certain bonds which are issued at a discount. So if let's say the bond is worth rupees 100, what will happen is you will be issued this at 100, and on maturity you will get 100 rupees back. So this discount which is there, which let's say for example there's a company who issues bonds, right? The company incurs a discount of 20 rupees, right? The liability it has to pay is ultimately 100. The discount on zero coupon bond is allowed as a deduction on pro rata basis having regard to the period of life of such bonds. So let's say the bond in this case, which is priced at 100, issued at 80, is for 5 years, right? So what is happening here is there's a discount of 20 rupees. So this 20 rupees is going to be spread over the life of the bond, which is 5 years. So every year you will get a deduction for 4 rupees as discount on a pro rata basis, right? Let us move on to the next slide then.